And we are rolling on 4/26 at UCLA, where it's another beautiful sunny day. The sunshine is shining. And we're about to hear a film speech from Grace.
Clement Stone once said that thinking will not overcome fear, but action will. And today, I want to share with you a film that has a lot of thinking, a lot of action, and some fear underlying it all. The film Good Will Hunting is filled with emotions, but three in particular had a lasting effect on me. This film made me feel laughter, it made me feel reflective, and it made me feel hopeful. Emmanuel Levy of Variety magazine wrote in 1997 that Good Will Hunting is funny, nonchalant, moving, and angry, effortlessly alternating its various moods, often within the same scene. And I completely agree with this because the film Good Will Hunting takes us on the journey of a young man trying to find his way in the world, and we can't help but keep our eyes glued to the screen the entire time. The first way that this film moved me was it made me feel laughter. The incident in the film that made me feel laughter was when Will and Skylar were on the date, and the two of them decided it would be a good idea to try to kiss while they were eating their burgers, and it didn't turn out as planned. This scene in the film reminded me of a time when I was on a date at this Italian restaurant, and we also thought it would be an excellent idea to pretend we were the dogs from Lady and the Tramp and eat one spaghetti noodle on each end till we got in the middle for a kiss. As we attempted this, the spaghetti noodle fell from our mouths onto the floor with a splat, marinara sauce everywhere, and as we both looked up, we realized the entire restaurant was staring at us. It was a great feeling. But even though we were really extremely embarrassed at the time, looking back, it's still a humorous memory that brings a smile to my face today. The second way the film moved me was it made me feel reflective. The incident in the film that made me feel reflective was when Skylar asked Will about his family, and he proceeded to lie and say he had 12 brothers that composed this big, happy family, when in reality this was a lie because he was a foster kid. This scene in the film reminded me of myself last year when an acquaintance of mine asked if both of my parents would be coming to family weekend here at UCLA. I proceeded to say yes, even though that was a lie, because I grew up with a single mom, so only my mom would be in attendance. I'm not ashamed at all that I grew up with a single mom. I'm extremely proud to say that, but in the moment, it was definitely a lot easier to tell this acquaintance yes and move forward with my conversation rather than get into the whole, my parents got divorced when I was one, and I've seen my dad three times in all of my 20 years. So this made me feel reflective of my own life and connected me to Will's easier to lie tactic. The third way that the film moved me was it made me feel hopeful. The incident in the film that made me feel hopeful was when Will packed up his car and went to go see about a girl. This always see is Will driving off into the sunset, roads of miles to ahead of him, and this made me feel hopeful because it reminded me of when I packed up all my things, got in my car, and drove myself to college. It was just me, my car, all of my belongings, and the hope for what was to come. Even though I took this drive 2 years ago, the scene in the film still reminded me that hope starts the moment you decide to do something about it. It doesn't matter where you are in your life at any given moment, just what you decide to do with that moment you were given. So, in summary, I have shown you three ways that this film moved me. It made me feel laughter, it made me feel reflective, and it made me feel hopeful. I've learned through this movie that fear is a powerful force in our lives. It's continually pushing our boundaries while also holding us back. And we have to learn to use that fear to move forward. So whether you are kissing in a restaurant, or you have the fear of telling somebody about your past, or the fear of hoping for what's to come, you should remember Clement Stone's words and don't think about that fear, but use that fear and create action to overcome it. There should be no doubt in this room that the movie Good Will Hunting really moved me. and that it continually has an impact on the way I decide to live my life. Thank you.
Thank you. 438. Okay, let's start over here today.
Hi, I'm Olivia.
Hi, Olivia.
I think you spoke very clearly. None of your words seem to run together, so I think you had very good articulation.
You can come in, Pritchie.
As well as, I think you emphasized, you had that vocal variety that emphasized what was important in the
remaining.
So I think that was very
helpful.
Thank you.
Okay. Good. Improvement?
Hi, I'm Paola. I really enjoyed it. I think you're very well spoken and you articulated everything really well. The only thing that I could foresee was that you had your hands behind your back, but that's about it.
The whole time. So you had a gun back there. Okay. Grace, yeah. Were you aware you had your hands behind your back the whole time?
No, not the whole time. I used my hands a little too much last time.
So you were overcompensated.
So I overcompensated.
Okay. Clement Stone quote was excellent. Thesis preview. Laughter, reflective and hopeful. Interesting emotions. Well, I'll talk about them when I get there. You knew your whole quote from Variety, which was impressive. It was a mouthful, and you said you agreed. Excelente, as they say south of the border. On laugh, you brought us back to the scene in the Italian restaurant where you tried to eat a single noodle, and it ended up on the ground, and we felt your mirth. The funniness of it, so you relive that emotion, and we felt it, and that was well done. On reflective, I guess that was the emotion that you were communicating here. I appreciate your honesty in telling us about your white lie about inventing a father that wasn't coming because he abandoned you 20 years ago and all this stuff. And that was excellent. That was very good, and that was very compelling. And I would have just liked a little more reflection on, because there's a truth in every lie, if you know what I mean. And so there was a real truth there, which was to say, so you're not exactly completely comfortable with having been raised in a single parent family. On your third emotion, hopeful, go see a girl in California. You shared with us you packing your car up and driving away. I would have liked you to have elaborated a little more on your hopefulness of the hopefulness of what was about to come in college, and your hopefulness, and you felt hopeful that a new chapter was opening in your life and that sort of thing. I can remember dropping my daughter off for college, and when I drove away, I cried like a baby. It was awful. You know, I thought, oh my God, is she going to be okay? So she didn't drive herself. I drove her, you know. So that was tough. So the hope could have been just better elaborated, I think. The summary and the conclusion was all good, and I like the way you came around and finally ended on your conclusion at the very end. So that was well done. You wanted more vocal variety. You said be emphatic, you were. Walk smoother. When you watch yourself tonight on YouTube, you'll see that you were a little bit sideways at times, so remember to keep it sheeted forward. And you wanted to have less ums. How'd it go?
I think it went better than last time, for sure, with the ums.
I do too.
Still, there were probably some, but...
And I think you did a nice job, and I think you understood the assignment and got the essence of what I was trying to teach for this speech. Thank you. Just a second. What's your name?
Matthew.
Matthew Broderick?
Dickerson.
Matthew Broderick, okay. Matthew Dickerson, okay, good. Okay. Let's give you a little stapler here. Oh boy, they adjust the camera. You're a little taller than the last girl. Wow. Yeah, don't come any further than the front of the green box, please. What?
I wrote that in my mind.
Yeah, okay. Your canine. Okay. Matt stands before you managing attention, communicating respect, making sure all phones and computers are closed, communicating respect non-verbally, saying to himself and really meaning it, I respect my audience. Finding friendly eyes near the front and the center, say your name, feel the love, start your speech.
I don't know if it's destiny or if life is accidental like a breeze, but maybe it's both. I think it's both. That's a quote by Forrest Gump, and I want to talk to you about destiny and coincidence. Now, destiny and coincidence are two overlapping themes in this movie where people typically side with one or the other. And I want to talk to you about how this film made me laugh. It made me cry, and it inspired me. A Rolling Stones review about the movie stated that the director doesn't want you to view The Fume as an ad for arrested development, but instead for a capacity for forces, capacity for hope, something that's rare in society today, in this age of cynicism, Godspeed. So I completely agree with this statement and this quote because yes, the movie's about a mentally challenged man who is naive about the world events, but also depicts his capacity for hope in the numerous events that happened in his life. So today, I want to talk to you about how it made me laugh was because it was an incident in the movie where he joined the military. He joined the military, and one of the first tasks was to assemble his weapon as quick as he can, and all while a drill sergeant is yelling in his face. Now, this made me laugh was because I'm on the football team, and we're scheduled, our schedule's crazy, right? We have to wake up at 5 o'clock every morning, and one of our mottos is be on time, be early, and be ready. And I did, my freshman year, I did the ultimate no-no, which was oversleep. And then I woke up and I saw the sun rise. I was like, I just knew I was in trouble. And one of the punishments for oversleeping was pushing a 2x4 board across the field at 4 in the morning, all while the coach is yelling at your face, you know, until he tells you to stop. And the scene made me laugh because I was able to relate to being yelled at, you know, while having to do a task. The second scene in the movie that made me cry was when Lieutenant Dan, one of the characters, was in Vietnam and his destiny was to die on the battlefield. And Forrest completely disregarded that and rescued him. Now this made me cry because in high school I broke my back. I was heavily recruited in high school after my junior season and I committed to UCLA. And all of a sudden, you know, I always had back problems. I was taking a lot of pain medicine. I was taking Advil, ibuprofen, dangerous amounts of it just to compensate, to play, to walk, you know. And so all of a sudden, a season was approaching. As practices were getting more intense, I had a lot to prove to everybody. I just collapsed. You know, all of a sudden I wake up and I'm trying to crawl off the field just to get up, you know, because I couldn't bear being on my feet. This incident made me cry because I knew what it was like to be broken. I knew it was like just to give up and say, just leave me here. You know, I don't see an end to this, you know. The doctor said I wasn't going to be able to walk again, let alone play football. So, but through persistent recovery and physical therapy, I was able to recover and get to where I am today. Now, lastly, besides making me laugh and cry, this film inspired me. And this film inspired me, especially one of the famous scenes where Jenny's like, run, Forrest, run, right? Well, Forrest always had a walking ailment. He couldn't, when he was young, he said that he couldn't, his back was crooked and he couldn't walk properly upright. And all of a sudden he was forced to escape some bullies, and all of a sudden he just burst out of his walking ailment shoes and ran like the wind. This inspired me because there's a lot of expectations that are placed on you to, you know, it's limited expectations. So when I was presented the opportunity to go to UCLA and attend UCLA, a lot of expectations placed on football players and a lot of the stereotypes placed on football players is to choose classes that are easy and just focus on football. Well, I wanted to go against that. You know, I still have a dream of playing in the NFL, but also I take my academics very seriously. I always had a love for medicine and I have a growing interest for medicine, and that's why I'm like one of the only football players that want to go to med school after my playing career. You know, I look at college as, you know, only 4 years of your life that, you know, you can just invest and put time into, enjoy the and reap the benefits after. You know, so I don't want to sit here 20 years down the road and be like, what if I push myself a little bit harder? If Forrest breaking out of his walking ailments and running like the wind doesn't inspire you, and because he becomes the fastest runner in the whole town, I don't know what will. In summary, you know, I told you how I laughed, I told you how I cried, I told you how it inspired me. You know, it made me laugh because I was able to relate to the drill sergeant. I was able to relate to being yelled at. It made me cry because I knew what it was like to be broken. I knew what it was like to come up and, you know, still see the light. And the words, run, Forrest, run, inspired me because I know it reminded me of to break the expectations and placed on you, even the ones that you don't even know about, you know. So whether these incidents in Forrest's life or in my life were because of destiny or because of coincidence or because of both, if this doesn't move you, I don't know what will. So I'm going to leave you with this. I don't know if it's because of destiny or if life is accidental, like a breeze. Maybe it's both. I think it's both. So that's it.
Thank you. Thank you for your feedback. 6'11".
Hi, I'm Jamie.
Hi, Jamie.
I really like your speech. I like, I'm sorry, just like your eye contact was really great with everyone, how you like kept constant, like, you didn't break the eye contact, which is things that we'll have to work on. I also really like how all of your speeches kind of had the unifying themes of football and destiny and coincidence, and how you said it to take things into your own hands.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Hi, I'm Catherine. I really like your speech.
What's your name?
Catherine.
Hi, Catherine.
Hi. I really like your speech. The only thing is that it was a little wordy, and you kind of went over time, so maybe in, like, your, like, reflective parts, you could, like, make it more concise and kind of, you know, sum it up a little bit more. And then in the end, you're going to say, like, there should be no doubt in your sphere of this, this, and this. And I don't think we need to go into, like, and make you laugh because of this, because you already covered that, but overall, it's really good.
Good. Catherine. Right. You didn't need to summarize twice. You got it done. You could have just said it made me laugh, cry, and inspired me. This was an excellent speech on the personal, emotional level. You really connected with your audience, and that was excellent. Thank you for not using the cliched opening from Forrest Gump. If I hear life is a box of chocolates again, I'll throw up. Yes, so this was an excellent alternative. Yes, thank you for that. So you had a good transition. Make your thesis a little more and your narrative a little more apparent with your voice. So today, I'm going to share with you this film, Forrest Gump. It made me laugh, cry, and inspired me a little bit more. You blackened it, but just a little bit more with your voice. Love the Rolling Stone quote. I thought it captured the essence of a movie. It really did, because this isn't a movie about arrested development at all. It's a movie about the capacity for hope, because we all have limitations and we all have to decide, like Forrest did. He's a metaphor for all of us and overcoming the limitations that we all have. That's why it was such a universally amazing hit. It really spoke to everybody on a million levels. It's an ambitious goal in this age of cynicism. Absolutely right. So, you told us that it made you laugh, and you confessed that you were late for practice, and you had to push a 2x4 across the field with your nose, which I suppose wasn't pleasant. And so that was funny, and the word picture of seeing you do that was good, and I suppose it taught you a lesson about punctuality. So that was well done. On the second emotion cry, best one. I wouldn't have buried it in the middle. I would have put it last. But you talk about breaking your back and being down and out and coming back from it. And it was very inspirational. And you talked about how you cried because you were broken. And yet you came back. And it was very inspirational and very emotional. And I feel you connected with everybody with that story, so it was excellent. And I feel you relived it and felt it, and that's what we're trying to learn to do. On the third emotion, about how you're inspired, you shared with us that you recognize that about one half of 1% of your class at the football stadium will make it to the NFL, and to think otherwise is delusional, and you need to get an education so that you can do something in the world besides football, and you're wise to do that. And so you've chosen med school, which is excellent. And so that was an inspiring and inspirational story, and it goes with your emotion of being inspired by Forrest. Your summary was too long. That's why you went over time. You didn't need to go over it again. And your conclusion, you need to always remember that the difference between a summary and a conclusion, the conclusion is your central point, which the film moved me. So there should be no doubt in this room, Forrest Gump really move me, and your tie back was excellent. Let's look at your canais. You said, I wanted to have an organized speech. You did. You didn't walk out of the green square except once, and have a solid conclusion to wrap everything up. How did it go?
I feel like the conclusion part went well, but the summary, like you said, over time, and you know, I felt like if I would have kept it shorter, I would have been in the time limit.
So. Right, okay. And did you practice under time conditions?
I tried, yeah. It's just different when you're up here.
Right, okay. You get kind of swept away a little bit, huh? Okay. Well, you did a good job, Matt. Thank you. Okay, let's hear from Sarah. Hi, Sarah.
Hi, how are you?
Great. You have everything here?
I think I do.
Your self-evaluation?
Yeah, there it is. Yeah, that should be at the very back.
Good. Film review from the deep internet. Good. Okay. Ooh, you're a server. Okay. Just a little. Let me adjust the camera. Okay.
Why do humans do science? Why do humans do art? The very things that are least important for our survival are the things that make us human. I wish I could take credit for those words, but they were spoken by Dr. Savas Demopoulos, who's a theoretical physicist and a protagonist in the film Particle Fever, which is a film that really moved me. Today I'd like to share with you a little bit about that film and tell you how it made me feel small, how it made me feel capable of creating things of importance, and how it inspired me. A.O. Scott of the New York Times said of Particle Fever that the experience of watching the film can be vertiginous. You toggle between the tiny and the infinite, between eternity and the real time of the recent past. I couldn't agree more. In watching the discovery of the Higgs boson unfold, I was incredibly aware of the importance of what I was seeing, and the experience felt simultaneously much, much bigger than me and very much a part of me. So the first way this film made me feel was it made me feel small. And there's really nothing like the universe to make you feel small. I was confronted by this fact for the first time when I was about 6 or 7 years old. I was in my room trying to fall asleep, and the only way I can think of describing it to you is like the universe swallowing me and spitting me back out into this vast, open, black, and empty space where I was disconnected from everything that was familiar to me, and it was terrifying. And I ran to my parents' room, as children do, and crying, I was trying to explain to my father that I was confronting my own mortality for the first time. And he did his best to explain something to me that he didn't fully understand. He told me that life and death is like unlocking a secret. We spend our entire lives trying to tap into it and trying to understand, and one day it's something we're all going to get let in on. And the universe is like that, too. It's vast, it's complicated, and it's so far beyond any of our understanding. And that's terrifying. But it's also incredibly beautiful that it's there and that it's something that we can all kind of seek to approach in that way. The second way this film made me feel was it made me feel capable of creating things of importance. Watching the discovery of the Higgs boson was fantastic because in many ways it represents the pinnacle of human achievement. It's remarkable to see the things that we can accomplish and the incredible depths to which we can understand things. And while I have not made any groundbreaking scientific discoveries in my time, it reminded me of writing my extended essay my senior year of high school, which was a sort of thesis, like the culmination of my studies. And it was a long and arduous process. It took a lot of hard work. And by the end of it, I had this product that I was really proud of and that I felt like in some ways was bigger than me, like I was trying to answer questions that were important not just to me, but also to other people. And from that experience, I learned that creating things is really important to me, that even though, relatively speaking, I may be a very tiny entity in this really large universe whose existence doesn't really matter in the scheme of things, I am capable of creating, which is incredibly powerful and beautiful. The final way this film moved me was it inspired me. And it inspired me to continue creating and to pursue the things that I'm passionate about. So I first saw this film during my freshman year of college. I was woefully undeclared, but I knew I was not going to be studying anything in the math and sciences. And while this film didn't make me better at calculus or qualify me to study quantum physics, it wasn't that good, it did encourage me to think about my education differently. It made me realize that the pursuit of knowledge doesn't have to be black and white, and that pursuing knowledge for the sake of pursuing knowledge is also valuable. I realized that in writing and in creating and seeking to understand other people, I too am trying to tap in to the same truths as those really, really advanced scientists. And to me, that's incredibly exciting and something that I'm inspired to continue doing. As A.O. Scott observed in his New York Times article, Particle Fever is a documentary about more than just the discovery of the Higgs boson. It's about human curiosity, about triumph, and about existentialism. And that's something that I think everybody can tap into. There should be no doubt in this room that this film moved me. As college graduation looms ever closer, I have felt pressure to make decisions based off of what's going to help me pay rent in 2 years. And while that's certainly important, it's also important to remember to invest time in things that you care about, regardless of whether they're going to earn you fortune and renown. And so I, as a result of watching this film, am going to seek to continue doing that, pursuing things that I'm passionate about and creating. Because as Dr. Demopoulos pointed out at the beginning of the film, my love for pursuing the unknown is what makes me human. Thank you.
Thank you. 452. Somewhere over here, I guess.
Hi, my name's Alyssa.
Hi, Alyssa.
Hi. So I want to say that I thought your speech was really fantastic. The thing that I think I liked most about it was that I really felt your passion for it. And I think that for me, that's one of the most intriguing things about a speaker is that I could really feel how much it was important to you. And it really, you also said things that really resonated with, I think, all of us. So I really enjoyed your speech. I thought it was great.
Thank you, Alyssa. Yes, please. Improvement.
Hi, Jessica.
Hi, Jessica.
I really liked it. Also, you were very articulate, which I really appreciated. My only thing is that you talked kind of fast, so maybe slow down. But other than that, it was really good. Thanks.
Okay. A little fast, she says. Okay. Did you feel you were rushing to get into the 5-minute range, or did you just feel it was normal, or what did you think?
I was conscious of the 5 minutes, but I think I'm a notorious fast speaker, so it's definitely an ongoing problem.
Okay. Let's talk about this speech, Sarah. You asked some deep questions, which we call rhetorical questions. Why do humans do science? Why do they do art? And your answer was they are least important for our survival, but they're the things that make us human. And I guess you tied back to this by tying back to the doctor quote at the end in Particle Fever. So you came the full circle. So you grabbed us and got our attention with those questions. Your thesis was you felt small, capable of creating things of importance and inspired. You had two quotes. From A.O. Scott in the New York Times, which I thought was good. And you agreed with it, so that was good. I think that you need to, for the audience of North Campus people, define Higgs boson so they know what you're talking about and what that discovery was, so that we don't have your audience know, oh yeah, and without giving a little quick explanation of that. So think, does everyone know what that is? And if not, a little quick explanation would be in order. So, four, let's talk about your feeling of being small. And for this, you shared your childhood experience of having a nightmare of being sucked up by the universe and maybe even dying or maybe near dying or something like that. And your father explained that death was like a joke and that one day we'll get the punchline and understand it. And you use that as an explanation for the same thing with the universe. One day we'll understand it or understand more of it. What I needed to have you come back to, Sarah, was to say, and as I look out at the stars, as I look around at all that we don't know, I feel small. Return to the feeling that you're communicating, and remind us what the feeling you're communicating at the end of your segment. Okay. Second, feeling was you said you felt made you feel capable of creating something of importance. And here you talk about your, I guess, senior thesis. And here I think I felt your, what I would say was your, you felt proud, really. And you felt you did create something of importance, that you stretched yourself. And so I wish you had come back and said something like, and that's why I felt, after I turned that in, I felt amazing. I felt stretched. I felt I'd done something creative and something new and something about myself. Okay. On your third feeling, inspired, well, here you talked about the fact that even though you didn't become a science major, this did inspire you to seek out other things, not just for it's going to help you get a job after graduation, but things you're interested in and things you want to know about, which is part of the goal of a well-rounded person, is to, you know, have a lot of interest in many things. A liberal arts education, liberal meaning broad. So that was good. And again, that's why I felt truly inspired at the end of that. Your summary was good. I liked the conclusion of another quote. You skipped your summary. Your conclusion was excellent, and your tie back was very good. Now, you said, do not rush, be more rehearsed and direct, and engage the audience and move more fluidly. How'd it go?
Well, I rushed.
Okay.
It was more rehearsed, I mean, objectively speaking.
Yes, now you practice more. Yeah. That's good. Yeah, that was apparent. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, with the moving fluidly, I feel like it's just something I'm going to get used to. For me, it doesn't feel natural to do the 3-5-3.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, it'll come. Yeah.
Okay. I may come to terms with it one day. But.
Well, what it does kinesically is it relaxes your body, and if you're holding any tension in having to move, you can't hold the tension in while you're moving. One other thing I would say about rehearsing and over-rehearsing is when you rehearse, and this goes for all of you folks who rehearse with the live person, say it differently each time, and you know, be searching and grabbing for words so it doesn't come to the point where it seems memorized. I'm saying yours was, but I'm just saying that's a danger in over-rehearsing. But overall, I agree with the comment. We felt your passion, and it was on a very esoteric topic and film, but it was well done with a few things that I mentioned about just locking in on the emotion you're communicating at the end of each segment. So thank you, Sarah. Okay, that'll bring us to Catherine.
Hello.
You have everything here?
Yeah.
Okay, don't come out of the green box. Yes, thank you. Okay. Catherine stands before you, managing attention, communicating respect nonverbally, finding friendly eyes near the front. Oh, your sweater doesn't fit. So roll your sleeves up so we can, when you gesture, we can see your hands. Good, that's better. Say your name, feel the love, start your speech.
Hi, my name is Catherine.
Hi, Catherine.
When was the last time you watched a film that made you feel a variety of emotions? The highest of highs and the lowest of lows in approximately 90 minutes. For me, this was 10 Things I Hate About You. This film really moved me because it made me laugh, it made me cry, and it inspired me. As Peter Bradshaw of The Guardian once stated, 10 Things I Hate About You is a smart, likable, and funny film that in the most unselfconscious manner possible is an homage to William Shakespeare. I cannot agree more with this statement. 10 Things I Hate About You is not only a very relatable film, but it also allows you to reminisce on your own high school experiences, the good and the bad. The first way this film made me feel was that it made me laugh. Although this film is comedic in general, the particular scene that made me laugh is when Patrick Verona attempts to ask Cass Stafford on a date. He does so in front of her entire PE class and sings Can't Take My Eyes Off of You in front of her entire PE class in the bleachers of their high school's football stadium. In doing so, Patrick strains his voice in addition to being carried away by the high school security team. I had a very similar experience in high school when my friend Justin asked his girlfriend Natalie to prom. Because I was a good friend of Natalie's, Justin enlisted me to help him choose a song to sing to Natalie in addition to performing it in front of her. Although Justin didn't have the greatest voice, it was really entertaining to me and all my classmates to see him attempt to do this very kind-hearted gesture in front of her. The second way this film moved me was that it made me cry. The scene in the film that made me cry is when Cass Stafford is asked to recite a poem in front of her entire English class. Cass Stafford, despite being the more conservative and introverted girl in her high school, decides to put all of her emotions on paper and recite a poem that's very appropriately titled 10 Things I Don't Hate About You towards Patrick Verona. This reminded me of an experience in high school. My sister was graduating, and I was asked to recite a speech in front of her entire senior class. Although my sister and I have had our fair share of arguments and hardships, this speech really gave me the opportunity to express to her how much I really cared about her and how much I would miss her when she left. When I was reciting the speech, I got really emotional, and I couldn't actually continue speaking in front of her class because I was overcome with so many emotions. I never realized how much my sister had taught me in spite of all the difficulties we had gone through. The third way this film moved me was that it inspired me. The part of the film that inspired me was when Kat decides to stand up to the school's bully, Joey. In doing so, she tells Joey that after years of tormenting her, she's finally decided to accept herself for who she is, the quiet introvert and the girl who will never be the typical teenage drama queen. This part of the film really inspired me because I had a similar experience when I was in middle school. I was bullied by a group of girls in ninth grade because I wore glasses. And although I was given the opportunity to wear contacts, I decided to wear glasses because glasses had become a part of my identity. Without my glasses, I was almost unrecognizable. And although people made fun of me for being four eyes, I didn't really care. So at the end of my ninth grade year, when I realized that I'd be attending a different high school than the girls who had bullied me, I decided to confront them. I told them how hurtful their comments were, and that after years of being bullied by them, I wasn't going to tolerate it anymore. I wasn't going to tolerate it anymore, and that I was happy with who I was. So, in summary, I've told you the three ways that this film moved me. It made me laugh, it made me cry, and it inspired me. There should be no doubt in this room that this film really, really moved me. So, as Peter Bradshaw from The Guardian so eloquently stated, 10 Things I Hate About You is a smart, funny, and likable film that in the most unselfconscious way possible is an homage to William Shakespeare, and I believe also to high schoolers around the world. 10 Things I Hate About You not only allowed me to reflect on my past and my good and bad high school experiences, but it also allowed me to reminisce on all of the good experiences I've had in my life thus far. Thank you. Okay.
3:37. What's your name? Brittany. Hi, Brittany.
I think it was very clear when you started, you were very clear and it was simple, like straight to the point. I like that. I like how you had like eye contact with all of us. It wasn't a problem. It was like natural for you. As well as walking as much as possible. And your last story too was very inspiring. I really felt inspired with your emotion too. It wasn't a good story.
Okay, thank you, Brittany. Any improvement?
Hi, I'm Grace.
Hi, Grace.
I also loved your speech. It was perfectly structured and you said everything you needed to say. Your talking was natural, but sometimes you turned to the side when you walked, even though it was still like a natural walk.
Okay. Thank you. Catherine, this was an example of a speech that wasn't too long. You really zipped through it. And when you watch yourself tonight on YouTube, you're going to see what you didn't give your audience a chance to feel your emotions or yourself a chance to do the felt sensing so deeply. You rushed over them a little bit and didn't linger on them so much. And you had, it was 3:37, 4:37, you had, you know, almost a minute 45 or a minute, yeah, to elaborate more. And you could have given us, could I get you to shut that door? These loud mouths are annoying me. Okay, I guess we'll have to bake in here. Okay. So, 10 Things I Hate About You. What an intriguing title. Laugh, cry, and inspire me. I like The Guardian. Good paper to quote from. And I like the link to William Shakespeare. On your first emotion about laugh, you gave us an experience where your friend Justin asked his girlfriend to go to the prom by singing on the roof, and it was pretty funny. I guess it would have been even better if it was you that he was singing to, but you know, I guess one step removed was good enough. But we got the funniness of it. What I want to say is, with the pace you were doing, I want to say what I just said to the last speaker was, slow down and almost search for words so it doesn't seem like it's just overly memorized, so that it's extemporaneous, so you're searching for words, okay? Because we lose a little of the meaning and the feeling when you're zipping along so quickly. Especially on the second one, and I would have made it third, when you talked about crying, and this was your big emotion where you were overcome in telling you weren't even aware that you had these emotions, except it slipped out in the middle of nowhere. And I've had this happen to me too. Things sneak up on you this way. And I would have liked you to have more remembered the emotion and felt sense it more and elaborated on it more. And said, and that's why I felt sad, and that's why I cried. Return to that emotion. On the third one, I like the story, Four-Eyed. It was a very sympathetic story, and I like the fact that you stood up to the bullies, and it was a good story. I wish at the end you was, and I felt so inspired. I felt so good that I finally stood up for myself and didn't take this guff any longer, because that's really what you have to do is, you know, someone kicks you, you kick back, and then it doesn't happen anymore. You know, at least that's been my experience. Your summary was fine. Your conclusion was fine. And your tie back to the rhetorical question was fine, and you answered the rhetorical question, urged people to watch the film. Your canis, you said, enunciate more, vary my tone, and place more emphasis on keywords and phrases. Keep my movement fluid, less jerky, and no distracting movements. How did it go?
I thought it went pretty well. I probably could have enunciated a little bit more and placed more emphasis on certain words. Mm-hmm. But I think, like, when you get up in front of a group, it's a little bit more difficult, and you kind of just, like, want to remember what you want to say. So I think for me, that's something I can definitely improve on, is emphasizing certain words.
Okay, yes. And I want you to have as your one of your canis next time to slow way down. And even if, and that means editing, and so your next speech is going to be a PC, and So even if you have to edit and say less, but slow down and, you know, be willing to let us savor your words a little bit more, I think you'll be a more effective communicator. Thank you. For you, managing attention, communicating respect. Now, can you take a step forward, please, into the middle of the box? Feet wider apart a little bit. Yeah, that's good. Yeah. Gotcha now. Perfect. Communicating respect non-verbally, finding friendly eyes near the front and center. Say your name. Feel the love.
Stay Hi, speech. I'm Grace.
Hi, Grace.
I'd like to start with a quote that's probably familiar to a lot of you. There's no place like home. To me, there really is no place like home. I've grown up in many different places, switching between my mom and dad's house, and so I found connection with home as with the people that I love and the people that I'm with. The movie I'd like to share with you today is The Wizard of Oz. Not only is it a revolutionary film in the sense it was the first to introduce color, but it was revolutionary to me in the different themes that it conveyed. Today, I'd like to share with you how this movie made me sad, it reassured me, and it made me determined. This film conveys a lot of different themes. As James Berardinelli said in his review for realviews.com, it's not only wonderfully entertaining, but the issues it addresses and the way it presents them is both universal and deeply personal. Therein lies the Wizard of Oz's true magic. I agree with this statement so much because not only is this movie a timeless classic, but it was deeply personal to me. The first way that this movie made me feel was it made me feel sad. As Dorothy wants to travel into a new world and experience new things, and once she's there, she just wants to go home to the people she loves. In October 2014, one of my best friends, Emma, was thrown into a whole new world at college in New Orleans. At the same time, her mom threw herself off the Golden Gate Bridge. And all I wanted to do was to be there for her, as her mom had gone through similar things before, and I had been there for her, been able to comfort her, but I was miles away and was unable to physically be there. So in this sense, she had to find the heart, her heart again, after this tragedy has occurred, and I wanted to be there for her, but she had to find heart in others around her at this time and through the other people that she loved as much as I couldn't be there for her. The second way this film made me feel was it reassured me. I grew up in many places, and all my friends moved around, and that made me feel quite lost. But this movie reassured me, because Dorothy found friends like in the whole new world that she experienced. And in that sense, like the Scarecrow, had to find brains and be consciously aware to connect with the people that are around her at that time. This last way this movie made me feel was it made me determined. Dorothy was faced with countless obstacles along her journey and would fight tirelessly to overcome them to be able to go home. I faced similar issues as a ballet dancer. Since I was 10 years old, I wanted to be a professional ballerina. And the way that this spoke to me is during audition season, you're constantly rejected. You go into the audition room, someone looks at you for 2 minutes and will kick you out. Rejection is hard to feel once, but let alone again and again, and having to go back confident the next day to the different company to show what you have. So this made me develop a tough skin, and the courage that the lion finally got in the end really spoke to me, as it took a lot of courage to go back, and I kept going back and was a professional ballerina for a few years. So in summary, I told you how this movie made me sad, it reassured me, and it made me determined. There should be no doubt that this movie moved me. It encouraged me to find home and take heart, brains, and courage to overcome any obstacle. As Bardinelli said in his quote, not only is this movie entertaining, but it is deeply personal, and I really felt that. So I encourage all of you to take heart, brains, and courage in overcoming any obstacles. Thank you.
Thank you. 422. Okay. We're somewhere. Okay, we'll go here. What did you like, sir?
Hi, my name is Dimitri.
Hi, Dimitri.
Grace, I really liked your speech. I think you organized it really well. I like how you you made the audience connect with the experiences you were giving out, and how you connected it with the movie, which I thought was really well also.
Hi,
Kat.
Hi, Kat.
I really enjoyed your speech also. I loved your examples. If I had one thing to say, it seemed like it was, you obviously memorized it, but it seemed so memorized that when you missed a word, you would say or and. So I could just tell, like, when there was like a little pause or like that.
Okay. Yeah, we want to start with that. Practice. When we practice extemporaneously and say it differently each time, because each time we've been around the sun another time and we're wiser and we know different things, and so we say it differently. Well, you started with the quote, "There's no place like home." And I like that. And you talked a lot about home and family and that sort of thing, and talked about oscillating between your mother and father's home in your beginning of your speech. And you had a good transition down to your thesis, in which you told us that you were sad, reassured, and determined, right? You knew your quote from James Berardinelli. That was a mouthful. And you knew the whole quote, so that was impressive. And you agreed with it. Very good. On the first story, you felt sad. And as you've heard me say to others, I'll get to the punchline and then come back to this. It was a very sad story that your friend Emma was off to college in New Orleans, and her mother threw herself off the Golden Gate Bridge, a horrific act. And you wanted to be there to comfort her, but you could not because you were somewhere else. And you went into that in some detail. What you needed to do also was to say at the end, and that's why I felt so sad, because I felt impotent, I couldn't be there, I couldn't hold her and comfort her and hug her and be with her as she cried and worried and wondered if she could have done something to prevent this, etc., etc. Okay? So, and that's why I felt sad. So return to the emotion, everybody, when you come to the end of your felt sensing. The second one, I don't know, maybe I'm just zoned out or something, but you were telling us that you were reassured, but I kind of missed your story on the second one. You tell us here that you moved from London to Hong Kong or San Francisco, and I didn't get much of that, and how reassuring it was to make friends in these places and that sort of thing. So remember, you want to say the film, she made friends along the way, and I moved a lot and I made friends along the way, and that's what reassured me, is I know I learned that I can, wherever I am, I can make friends along the way, and that's what reassured me. See? On the taught you about determination. This was your best story about getting rejected countless times and countless times and countless times and developing a thick skin. And that was very good. And I could feel your pain at the feeling of rejection. So you were remembering it and feeling it and telling us about it. And then you gave us the punchline that you got into a company and got through it and acted as a professional ballerina first for a few years. Again, the only thing was, and that's why, the film taught me about determination. Summary was good. Your conclusion was fine. No doubt in this room was it was really moved me. I like your tie back, but I would like you to have emphasized more of the home aspect of your tie back rather than what you did talk about, traveling and the rainbow and learning from this film. So overall, let's look at your canines. You wanted to vary your tone, you wanted to walk correctly and make good eye contact. How'd it go?
Well, I didn't walk at all last time, so I think the walking went better. I'm pretty sure I made better eye contact.
Yes.
I think I varied my tone more, but I wasn't as aware of that.
Yeah, work on that even more, that emphatic style. And when you practice, it won't seem memorized if you grab for words as you're remembering it and do it extemporaneous style. So you did a nice job, and thank you for doing it today, Grace. Thank you. Okay, any more C's? Okay. You're a C? You're a C? Okay, how did I miss you? I must be blind. Okay, good. You need to use the green meaning. There you are, right there. Okay, good. Hang on a minute, Jamie. Alright, that's what happened here. Okay. It's out of order. Jamie stands before you, managing attention, communicating respect, finding friendly eyes near the front and the center. Say your name, feel the love, start your speech.
Hi, I'm Jamie.
Hi, Jamie.
So, what did one dinosaur say to the other? Nothing, because dinosaurs are extinct. But I'm going to tell you about a world where dinosaurs are not extinct, and that would be in Disney Pixar's The Good Dinosaur. As Joe Morgenstern puts it in the Wall Street Journal, as Pixar productions go, The Good Dinosaur is not groundbreaking, but it's heartfelt and endearing, and visually splendiferous, and kids will love it for sure. I agree with this quote, as The Good Dinosaur is definitely not as deep as other recent Disney films, such as Inside Out or Zootopia, but it definitely moved me. The Good Dinosaur moved me by making me appreciate the beauty of the world. It made me cry, and it made me feel brave. So the way The Good Dinosaur made me appreciate the beauty of the world was a scene where Arlo, the main character, and Spot, they go out and they come across a field of fireflies, and they play in the field under the starry sky. This reminded me of a time in high school where we went on a retreat to the mountains. I grew up in a town where there's a lot of urbanization, there's a lot of light pollution, and you can't see the stars or nature. But on this retreat, we went to the mountains and we went out on a hike at night, and we had the opportunity to just turn out all the lights, and we were able to see all the stars, and it really put me in awe how beautiful nature could be. And it was just something that was different from what I could see normally. Now, the way the Good Dinosaur made me cry was spoilers, at the beginning of the movie, Papa gets swept away by a flood in front of Arlo and he dies. So that made me cry because it reminded me of a pain I had in my life. So fortunately, my parents are both still alive, but my mom has been diagnosed with cancer twice, one when I was 11 and one just last year. And this was really hard for my family, and I felt like Arlo, how I felt small and helpless, like I couldn't do anything for her or the family. But like Arlo, I tried to do my best, and this is like, even though we tried to do our best to make the most out of what we're given, it still does hurt, so that's why The Good Dinosaur made me cry. And lastly, I would like to talk about how The Good Dinosaur made me feel brave. For the majority of the movie, Arlo was lost away from home, and there is a moment when he comes across a family of friendly Tyrannosaurus Rexes, and they give him the courage to continue his journey. This made me feel brave because it reminded me of the time I felt lost, and that would be when I came to UCLA. Coming to UCLA was different for me because this is the first time where I had like an environment where I didn't know anyone, and it's not even far away from my home. I live like 30 minutes from here. But I still felt lost and out of place. But I felt brave. In hindsight, I feel brave because I know that over the past few years, I've gone through a lot of experiences and have met a lot of people that have given me the courage to continue my journey here at UCLA. So in summary, The Good Dinosaur has made me appreciate nature, has made me cry, and has made me feel brave. So what did one dinosaur say to the other? In the movie, The Good Dinosaur, Papa tells Arlo, sometimes you have to get through your fear to see the beauty of Sometimes you have to get through your fear to see the beauty on the other side. And I feel like this is a theme that even though The Good Dinosaur is a very simple movie, very straightforward, very much for children, it's got themes like this that we can all resonate with. Themes that say that sometimes we'll have to struggle and sometimes we'll have to face fears, but on the other side there's beauty. Thank you.
Thank you. 402.
Hi, I'm Claire.
Hi, Claire.
I thought you told it like your speech very naturally, and it felt almost more like a conversation than you talking at us, which was really good, and it showed that you knew it really well.
Hi, I'm Grace.
Hi, Grace.
I love the joke. It's really funny. But I think if there's anything to work on, just maybe a little bit longer eye contact, and like when you're over on this side of the room, look to this side of the room.
Okay, good. Those are good thoughts. were you making 4 to 5 seconds of eye contact? Were you aware of that?
I think I was trying to,
rule,
but it's hard because nerves. Mm-hmm. I definitely know I'm
okay. Well, make it one of your canais. Let's talk about your speech, Jamie. You started with a joke, and I appreciate that. No one has started with a joke, and you kind of ended with the joke or kind of tried to go back to the joke in sort of a joking way, I guess. And so that was pretty good. So thank you for trying a joke as a start team out of a speech. One of the dangers, of course, it wasn't true in your case, but as you heard from your classmate here, but you want to try your jokes out on friends to make sure they're funny, because one thing that can be disheartening to a speaker is to tell a joke and then everyone goes silent, right? And then, ooh, I bombed. So, but you didn't, so that was good. You said the film helped you appreciate nature, cry, and to feel brave. You quoted the Wall Street Journal and said you agreed with the film review. And that was good. Now, one thing I noticed, and take your hands out from behind your back, and one thing I want you to notice tonight when you watch yourself on YouTube is you're not gesturing a lot with your hands. And I'd like to see you move your hands more. One of the things that I did get on film was you're playing with your little zipper there a lot. You were like that, you just did now. You were touching it in a nervous habit, and that's a little distracting. So if you're just gesturing naturally with your hands, let them gesture naturally. It'll be more effective. Let's talk about your first emotion in which you came to appreciate the power and beauty of nature. When you lived in an urban environment in Long Beach, which I guess is a beach town, but you say there's little nature there, and you went to into the woods, and you went out at night and saw the stars and were amazed, and we could feel your sense of wonder. That was pretty good. Just remember to say, and that's why I came to appreciate nature. On your second emotion, cry, you shared with us that your mother has come down with cancer twice. This was probably your best thing. I wouldn't have buried it in the middle. But thank you for sharing that with us. You shared with us your feeling of helplessness, because there really isn't much you can do but be supportive and hope the treatment works, right? Yeah. But that was, if you remember the feeling and almost come up to feeling the crying again, and almost start to cry again, that's the most effective point of felt sensing. Do you remember I used the metaphor of the razor's edge or not? And you want to be right on the edge of crying, but not cry, not super rational. Oh, I cried when my mother got cancer. That sounds a little, impersonal. Whereas if your voice breaks a little, I cried when my mother got cancer. See, it's a little different. Okay. On your third emotion, brave, you spoke about coming to UCLA and not knowing anybody and feeling alone, just like Arlo was lost, and yet you point out that you have gotten through it and made friends and been brave and just carried on, and that's why you felt brave, and again, repeat the feeling that you're communicating. Didn't quite get the brave feeling so much that like I did the emotion of crying, but I got where you were trying to go, I guess. Yeah. Summary was fine. You skip the conclusion. There should be no doubt in this room that the good dinosaur really did move me. And your tie back was fine. Your canines. I hope to have more confidence. I hope to have more facial expression. I hope to have more variation in my voice. How did it go?
I think the voice one was probably the most successful because I definitely feel more nervous than I did the first day.
Uh-huh.
And in terms of facial expression, I can't tell until I watched the video, but I know when I watched the video the first time for the respect speech, I looked like I was in pain.
Uh-huh, yeah. Like you were dying or something. Yeah. Okay. What I say to people that feel they don't have confidence is fake it till you make it and just walk up there quickly and confidently. I've got confidence. I'm the best speaker in the whole world. And then pretend to be confident. And after a while, you will be the confident speaker that you envision yourself to want to be. Overall, other than the things that I mentioned, you did a nice job. So thank you, Jimmy. Are there any more C's? Okay, let's see, what's our time like? Do we have any B's that were absent that need to make up their speeches? Are there any A's that were absent that need to make up their speeches? Okay. All right, now we have time for one introductory speech. Anybody up for an introductory speech? Okay, I guess our work is done for the day. Return with honor. Operation or something?
Oh, yeah.
How'd it go?
Oh, good. Everything's fixed
up. Did it hurt?
Did it hurt?
Yeah, did it hurt?
Yeah. It's all my pain.
Thank you so much.
That's not good.
Yeah. So did I emailed you about my study buddy definitely dropped the class.
Oh, who's that?
Lauren. It's Lauren Yee.
Lauren Twos. Yeah. And yeah. So you don't have a study buddy.
Yeah. So do I have to have a new one? Should I still do my introduction speech about her?
No, do it about yourself.
About me?
Yeah, you just do yourself.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, just do the 7 parts about yourself.
Okay. All right.
Hi. On Tuesday when you distributed the, or Thursday when you distributed the midterm, my partner wasn't here, but she actually got the midterm from you beforehand.
Yeah.
So do you want me to like give you her mid, like the extra one that I got? Do you want that back?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. So the midterm is due on Thursday, and it's like not open book or anything, right? We just work with our study buddy.
You're supposed to be your study buddy, yeah.
Okay. Cool. So if our study buddy is not here on Thursday, do I just turn in my test? Or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Who's your study buddy?
He's Zeus.
Okay, yeah. He said that he emailed me that he had an operation.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Yeah, okay, good. Okay.
Okay, this was hers that you asked me to get for her.
So she has it already.
Yeah, she, I guess, came to you beforehand.
Okay, good.
She was going to pass it.
Yeah, okay, good. Yeah.
Thank you.
Should I write my name in though? I thought
so. Yeah.
Also, I wanted to ask you, football always has to do a lot of interviews.
What now?
We have to do a lot of interviews.
Yes.
After practice. Like, I don't know if there's any like particular etiquette for addressing an interview, or do you just talk directly to the person that asked you the question, or do you talk to the herds?
No. Well, when you're interviewing, you look the person in the eye. Is it being filmed?
It's filmed.
Yeah, I would look the person in the eye. I'd be direct, smile a lot, be honest and direct. Okay, thank you, Pratik. Yeah. How's that midterm coming?
I'm reading the chapters.
And applying. And are you working with your study buddy?
Yeah.
I think the other thing I'd do is if you have a little camera like this, these are very helpful to have. I do.
Just videos of interviews like I'm meaning to.
Yeah. Interview. Have somebody interview you, and then watch yourself and get a critique of it, and to get feedback on how you appear. Some people say like and uh-huh and, you know, have a lot of bad, aren't well spoken. You know, have a lot of bad fillers and, you know, just aren't very likable. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, they're rolling their eyes, they don't look people in the eye and that sort of thing. But that's what I'd suggest. When I was working with Caitlin on her graduation speech, we videotaped it a few times and changed some things. So I believe in video. Yeah. But if you have somebody that's trusted that can look at your, you know, interview and give you feedback, that's good. That'll give you honest feedback, you know, and not blow smoke up your nostrils. That's good. You know, oh, yeah, you're the greatest. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know.
I guess. Yeah. Well, thank
okay.
you.
You're welcome. Yeah. Okay.
Professor,
sir,
I wanted to ask you about the
Yes, about what?
The canai that we are supposed to include in our speeches.
The canai, yes. Yeah. Constant, never-ending improvement. Those are to be what you think the three things you need to work on the most.
Okay, but is that part of the self-evaluation form? Or
no, that's separate.
Oh, that's separate.
Yeah.
So you're supposed to include it in the speech. And so it, can it be like similar to the things you put in the self-evaluation form?
It can be similar, yeah, but what are your three canai? Are you coming up on your speech next time?
Yeah, on Thursday.
Yeah. How is it?
As in, how is the speech?
Yeah. Have you practiced
yeah.
it with a person?
No, I haven't practiced with a person. I've just made sure that I've timed it properly so that I don't overtime
it. You need to practice it with a person.
Okay.
The big thing that I'm worried about for you is it'll be clinically good, but not have good emotion.
Oh yeah, I
because you're kind of, you know, heady and not emotional, and this is an emotional speech.
Yeah,
that's the purpose.
Yeah, no, definitely. I actually got that purpose, and after.
So why don't you have a Insia come over and practice with you, or Vidya.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I actually saw Olivia's speech. I think you told me to watch her speech.
Oh, yeah.
I got what you're trying to say about it being very
emotional.
Did
you see how genuine
yeah.
she was and how she relived the emotion?
Yeah.
You have to relive the emotion.
Yeah, definitely.
And if you do, you'll be fine. Okay. Do I want you to take this next door to my other class? No. It's empty.
Okay.
Yeah, well, you should be okay.
Okay.
Okay, good.